So I'm now ready to dive into hardware-intensive techniques to try and improve performance. And one of the clear disadvantages of doing this is that these hardware-intensive techniques consume more power and energy. Okay, so before we dive into those techniques, let us first review the basics of power consumption and energy consumption and look at a few options that architects have to try and reduce this power and energy. Okay, so the first thing that we need to realize is that power has two major components, dynamic power and leakage power. Okay, so dynamic power is the power that is dissipated every time transistors switch. Okay, so it is a function of activity, that is how many transistors are switching every single cycle. It is a function of the capacitances of those transistors. And then there is a very important effect over here, the voltage squared and frequency. Okay, these are two very important aspects that architects or users have control over. Okay, so what we're saying is that the supply voltage has a quadratic relationship with power. So power is a function of voltage squared. And frequency has this linear relationship with dynamic power. The second component is leakage power. That is, you know, when transistors are just sitting there, even if they're not doing any work, as long as they're powered up, there will always be some leakage current that is slipping away from the supply voltage to ground. Okay, and so the total leakage power that is being dissipated is a function of transistor count. That is, how many transistors do I have in my chip that are connected to the supply voltage? It is a function of the leakage current. And then it is a function of the supply voltage itself, okay? Because, you know, power is voltage times current. So if there's some leakage current slipping, the power that is being dissipated is a function of the supply voltage. Okay, so, you know, we have to take into account both of these factors when we reason about power consumption. And the leakage this leakage component cannot be ignored, because in many processes that are operating at typical utilizations, the leakage component can account for about 25% of total power. Okay, so it's not something that can be ignored. And this leakage component will, of course, change with utilization levels, right? So if the processor is not very heavily utilized, then the activity is low and dynamic power is going to be close to zero, which means leakage will account for most of the power dissipation. Whereas in a heavily utilized processor, the leakage power may be a little bit less than 25%. Okay, so the next thing we need to understand is energy, which is simply power into time, right? So hopefully everyone remembers this from their basic high school physics. And, you know, if you have a program that runs for 3 seconds on a 100-watt processor, then the energy being consumed is P into T, which is, in this case, 300 joules. Okay, so now with these basics in place, you know, let's go through a few examples and let's see, you know, what metric is appropriate when comparing two different processes. Okay, so the options before us are to use, you know, power, to use energy, and to just use, you know, execution time. Okay, and so, you know, I'm going to explain these metrics with this example over here. So let's assume that processor A consumes 1.2x the power of processor B, but it also takes, you know, 30% less time to finish a given program. Okay, so which of these two processes should I choose? Okay, now, if my program has a given performance deadline, and only processor A is able to meet that deadline, okay, so if performance does matter, and processor A is able to deliver the required performance, and B is not able to do that, then clearly A is the winner, right? So if there is a performance constraint, and only one processor meets it, then I should obviously go with that processor. The second constraint is power consumption. Okay, so you know, let's say that I have a given cooling solution, right? Let's say I have a fan sitting next to my processor that is sucking all the heat away. Okay, and that solution is adequate for processor B. Okay, but A consumes 1.2x more power, and that same cooling solution does not work very well. Okay, if I want to cool processor A, I need to go with some other fancier cooling technique, something that, say, needs liquid cooling. If I need that, then my cooling costs go up dramatically. Okay, so if I'm constrained by cooling costs, then I should go with processor B. Okay, so, you know, if I have a simple fan that works very well for both A and B, then you can pick either one of those two. Okay, but if my simple cooling solution only works for processor B and does not work for processor A, then B is a clear winner. Okay, so if I'm constrained by either time or power, I should go with either A or B. But if both the processors do well on these two metrics, right? So let's say that, you know, A and B are both able to meet the performance deadline, and both A and B can be cooled with a simple fan. Now, which one do I pick? Now, in this case, I should be looking at energy, because energy tells me, this energy metric tells me the true cost of finishing a given amount of work. So ultimately, I'm going to be billed by the power company for the energy that I consume. Okay, so I should be focusing on how much energy it takes me to finish a given task. Okay, so energy in this case, so if processor B takes consumes P power and takes T time to finish a task, processor A would do, you know, 1.2P, and the time it takes is 0.7T, so its total energy dissipation is 0.84PT, whereas the energy dissipation of processor B is PT. Okay, so based on this, I should conclude that A consumes less energy for that given task, and hence that is what I should go with. Okay, so there are different ways to pick these processors. Okay, if performance really matters, then I should go with the higher performing processor. If cooling cost matters, then I should go with the processor that dissipates less power. And if both of these metrics are, if both processors meet those two criteria of power and time, then I should go with the processor that consumes less energy. Okay, so now, you know, let's talk about what control architects possibly have over reducing power and energy. And there are many things you could do. So for example, if some transistors are inactive, then you should gate off their supply voltage to reduce their leakage power. You can also do other things such as designing for the typical case, and then depending on activity, you can throttle up or down. Okay, so that leads to these two techniques called dynamic frequency scaling and dynamic voltage and frequency scaling. Okay, so let me try to explain the effects of these two techniques with a detailed example.